Kashmir has always been in the limelight at international forums. It is pertinent to mention here that on 5th August 2019, Indian government has revoked special status of Jammu and Kashmir and bifurcated the erstwhile state of Jammu and Kashmir into two union territories, Jammu Kashmir and Ladakh. Today, we have with us Khurram Parvez, a prominent and worldly renowned human rights activist. Khurram is coordinator at Srinagar-based Writers Body, Jammu Kashmir Coalition of Civil Society. Thank you, Khurram, for being with us. First of all, I would like to ask you, how do you see the overall situation of Jammu and Kashmir as far as human rights is concerned, especially after the abolition of Article 37?
The situation of human rights in Jammu and Kashmir has been bad in last 30 years. But since last year, after the abrogation of Article 370, we saw that the government has used its heavy military might to enforce silence in Jammu and Kashmir. The government does not want anyone to react or condemn what it has done. So they have tried to arrest hundreds of people, which are activists, businessmen, lawyers, politicians, local level mobilizers. So everyone who had the capacity of mobilizing anyone was arrested. So in all, at least between 8,000 to 10,000 people were arrested last year after the abrogation of Article 370. And also there were widespread allegations of torture, and also people who, because internet was banned and phone was banned, so people did not have an option to express themselves anywhere. So they were not able to express. So for months, there was complete silence from Kashmir. People didn't know what was happening. And since then, we have also seen that people, the number of encounters have increased, and in which some of the encounters, according to local people who live around these vicinities where these encounters have taken place, people allege that there was disproportionate force used in most of the encounters. And also we have seen that in Shopian area, we saw that there was a fake encounter in which three people who were from Rajouri district who had come to Shopian for I think daily wage work. So they were there for employment. They were abducted and killed in a fake encounter. So it appears that they were civilians, and it appears that they were killed, of course, for rewards, because there was no other reason, at least which is known publicly.
Also, it appears clearly that from last several years, we have reached a stage where government has completely criminalized politics in Jammu and Kashmir. They do not want to allow any space for politics.
So what we have seen overall, the pattern is that anyone who speaks, because recently we saw when internet was resumed in Jammu and Kashmir, people who were writing on Facebook or Twitter, they were also summoned to police stations. So there are cases filed against many young people, including journalists now, for doing stories.
We are living in the middle of the pandemic. Many jail inmates contracted the COVID-19 virus. So what is the international procedure, what are the international laws related to these prisoners, especially political prisoners?
Primarily, first, these political prisoners who are booked under Public Safety Act, they are booked in preventive detention. So there is no crime which has been proved against them. There is no specific allegation for which they are being tried in the court. So their detention is a human rights violation. Just the mere detention of these people under preventive detention laws like Public Safety Act. So therefore, for us, they should not be in the jails at all, these people. They are being jailed because government does not feel confident if these people are outside the jails. Government says they will instigate the public opinion. But that's the right of the people to express their opinion. So government has tried to criminalize the opinions which are other than the opinion of the government. So that is not how democracy works. So these people who are now in jails, they should have been released because Supreme Court had decided that the jails should be decongested because of the COVID. And we saw that the most important people who should have been released immediately should have been those people who were not booked for any serious offenses. So preventive detention people were not there for any serious crime. There is no crime which has been attributed to them. So they should have been released. But we saw that these were the people who were not released. Several other people were released. So then international organizations as well as UN expressed its fears and opinions. So after that, we saw some people amongst these preventive detention detainees, amongst them the older people and those who were not well, they were released. But despite that, we saw many people in Srinagar Central Jail and also in Mutton District Jail, they contracted coronavirus. So far, according to our estimates, the number of people who contracted virus inside the jail in Valley, their numbers are around 200. It could be more as well. We don't know how many more people, because there is not much transparency on these issues.
Recently, Jammu Kashmir Coalition of Civil Society compiled a report titled Kashmir's Internet Siege. Many analysts call it digital apartheid. How do you see when a person is deprived from internet, how human rights violations?
When internet became a reality in India, it did not become a reality in Kashmir. So internet already came late to Jammu and Kashmir, because at that point of time, the intelligence agencies, the armed forces opposed the use of mobile phones, and also they opposed the use of internet in Kashmir. So internet came after a lot of interventions of politicians, activists, many people across the world. And finally, when internet came, we saw that repeatedly internet was throttled. We saw that in 2008, in 2010, SMS services were banned. We saw internet was several times banned because there were protests being organized. So governments would always say that internet makes it easier for the protest mobilizers to mobilize people. So therefore, they would ban internet. So they say that this creates law and order problem. So because of that kind of framework, mental framework in the mindset, in the mindset of the government of India, we have seen that the opinion is that Kashmiris should not receive the basic facility of internet. In today's world, when half of the businesses are dependent through internet, and people use internet for normal communication as well, people use internet for normal learning as well. So when you deprive people from this, you are not just only depriving people from entertainment or communication, you are also depriving their income generation capacity. So Kashmir, in Kashmir, India has created a history. The internet throttling and the banning is unprecedented in the world, the kind of ban which they have implemented here.
Do you think demographic change in India, only Muslim majority in the region, is a development that could increase the possibility of heightened conflict?
Demographic changes in Jammu and Kashmir have not happened only today. It started in 1947. In 1947, according to the conservative estimates, at least 500,000 people, 5 lakh people in Jammu province were forced to migrate to Pakistan, and Pakistan administered Kashmir. So since then, they have not been allowed to return. The right to return of these people is an internationally guaranteed right. These are people who should be allowed to come back to their homes. But we see that they have not been allowed. Their properties were then kept under a particular department here, which was called as Evacuees Property Department. So this was a custodian department here, which kept these properties. But if you see in Jammu province, most of these properties are illegally occupied by people. And some at some places where the properties are not illegally occupied, they have been allotted to the local civilians. So those people who are beneficiaries of the properties of these migrants from Jammu who went to Pakistan have always opposed the return of Jammu Muslims, the more than 500,000 people who migrated then. So we feel that that created a complete demographic change in the Jammu province then. But of course, the government of the day today wants to expedite the process of demographic changes. they're doing it at a very fast pace. This is something where we feel that people in Ladakh, people in Jammu are equally opposed to the government's efforts. They are also not happy with what government is doing. So it's not only Kashmiris who are against these demographic changes. The freedom of press in Jammu and Kashmir was never there. We have seen that media people have been attacked in early 90s. Media people continue to be attacked. We saw in recent years journalists like Shujaat Bukhari were killed. We saw in last 1 year journalists like Pirzada Ashik, Nasir Ganai, Gauhar Gilani, Masrat Zahra, and many others were threatened and banned. There were cases filed against them. They were summoned to police stations, and there were many other journalists who were summoned to police stations for their stories. And then we see also journalists like Asif Sultan, who is incarcerated in jail from last 2 years. There's another journalist from South Kashmir, Qazi Shibli. He was in jail for more than 9 months. Then he was rearrested, a case was filed against him. So this is a continuous phenomenon. This is something which we saw in early 90s. In early 90s, it was very brazen. And in between, for a few years, we saw that government had tried to sophisticate its means of pressurizing or controlling the media. But now it's again becoming brazen.
Recently, International Day of Disappeared has been observed. Jammu and Kashmir Coalition of Civil Society has done various reports on past. Do you think, comparatively, 90s and today's era, have you seen some sort of changes as far as disappeared persons are concerned?
No, I mean, what we saw is that early 90s, there were the number of disappearances were far bigger.
Mm-hmm.
So with the years passing, our campaign succeeded in creating the attention on the issue of enforced disappearances in Jammu and Kashmir. And there was, because of global pressure, because of internal pressure, government felt pressured, and therefore the number of disappearances came down. This was happening, consistently. And in last few years, we observed that the disappearances phenomenon had gone down tremendously. There were only a handful of cases happening every year. But we have seen resurgence in the issue of cases of enforced disappearances in last 1 year. That is, of course, because of what is happening in Jammu and Kashmir. The political climate is becoming very hostile against the people, and people want to retaliate. There are people who want to resist what is happening. So in this resistance and then counter resistance by government, we see the possibility of disappearing people, torturing people, killing them in custody. That has increased, and that possibility has led to some killings already.
The Jammu and Kashmir Coalition of Civil Society is working from past 30 years. What is the main objective or immediate objective, we can say, for the Coalition of Civil Society?
Our main objective has been and will continue to be protection and promotion of human rights. We feel that our mandate is not the mandate connected to the dispute here in Jammu and Kashmir. Even after the resolution in Jammu and Kashmir, we will continue to fight for the rights of the people, because the situation is that any government, whether it's Kashmir or anywhere else, is a violator of human rights, and there have to be some watchdogs who will fight for the rights of the people. And that is what JKCCS is doing. We are raising voice against the human rights violations, irrespective of the involvement of those people whose rights are being violated, and also irrespective of who is violating their rights, whether these rights are being violated by the state actors or non-state actors. So Jammu and Kashmir Coalition of Civil Society believes in speaking and standing up for the rights of oppressed people, whosoever is the oppressor.